Well, guess what we're gonna go do? We're gonna go and do some protilling. So I'm gonna fire this tractor up. I've been waiting for an opportunity to get to use this thing, and I'm super excited about it. Now it does have a little bit of bird poop on it. Hasn't been used in a little while. Actually, hasn't been used in a long while. We're gonna give her a fire up here. Oh. Got an error code there, no big deal. Always just do the power off and we're off to the races. Come on. Weird. Very strange. Power it off again. This happened to me one time before, I think. There it goes. Strange. Maybe it's because it's been sitting a long time, but that took a little bit longer than what I would like to get going. And the error code had nothing to do with it. It's a front axle error code. It's been coming up. I need a new sensor in the front axle suspension thing, something like that. Okay, we're gonna go and def up, top up with some fuel. We're just gonna wheel up and grab some fuel. Only three fence left. They're getting hauled to town to get updated. Man, is this 1050 quiet. Forgot how quiet this thing is. That's our hockey rink. Have to do a video maybe this winter of us playing some hockey or something on it. We are Canadian, you know. And to fuel these bad boys, everything is keypad. All locked up. Every person on the farm has a different code. We can track how much fuel everyone uses. Really, we find that very valuable. These are summer, and that's winter fuel, and then that's gasoline. We go through a lot of fuel. So anyway, I gotta get filling here. Just like that, we're done fueling. Oh. That's rock and roll. Okay. We got about a 70K move, so we're gonna go pick up the Protill from a local co-op who rents them. So we're gonna go and do that. Because ours is busy full-time right now, so we need a little extra hand here to help get done, because actually we won't even get done. It's supposed to snow. Today is November 5th, I think. It's supposed to get like 40 centimeters of snow here on the weekend, so we're thinking that's probably gonna shut us all down for the rest of the year. This is abnormal temperature, this 20 degrees that we're getting right now. So, I'm gonna start my trip. All right guys, it's a windy one here. We just got here to hook up this Protill. It's a rental from a co-op, just looking it over. See some of the rubbers are trying to come out. You know, rental units, look at this, coming right out. They sure get abused. I feel bad for them. Like, I don't normally rent because we have our own, but just due to the circumstances. Like, when was the last time these pins were ever greased? I don't think they ever were. And I don't think they'd ever take grease now, to be quite honest with you. Like, even up here. Ah. That's too bad. They don't get greased. Obviously, they're getting, like, beat up pretty good. The rubbers are coming out. That's too bad. That's not how I run things. But, yeah. And the thing is, you can try and grease them, but if they haven't been greased in a long time, they'll never take it. Never take it. All right, well, I'm going to finish hooking up here. Got to hook up my hydraulic hoses, and then we're going to hit the road and keep going. So now I'm just going to lower this jack down. This jack is hydraulic. I have it hooked up to the external hydraulic outlets on the vent. Oh, that's up. Must be up. Oh, that's up. There it is. Ooh. That sure set my tractor down. How much did it set down? Oh, not bad. Sure did set it down, though. Almost touching in there. Now, there is more weight on the hitch right now, just due to it being winged up. Once you put the wings out and go protilling, it will pick a lot of weight off this thing. Okay, I'm going to pop these back out, hook them in, hook the wings and all my rollers and all that fun stuff in, and we gotta get going. So we're actually just waiting here. I asked for a grease gun if they happen to have it. I'm going to try to get some grease into these things. I don't know how successful I'm going to be, but I just can't. I can't do that without trying to put some grease in there. At least try. I actually got most of these to take grease. That's a beautiful sign, you guys, but that is super dry. Some though, I was not successful with getting to take grease, but I found this thing's quite broke up. So there's four of these brackets, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Well, the top on this one's broke right off. And on the same side, that one's broke right off. So there's only two brackets holding this whole set of gangs on. Frame crackage right here. And I found something else. This bracket down here is cracking on the bottom set of gangs. So I pointed out these, like that's a serious concern because I could lose this whole row. So I said I'll take it very easy. I think they might have to change out this whole clamp. Maybe you could get a good bead weld on there. That'd be a good welder, better than me, I guess. Might have to change this whole bracket. We gotta pull the gangs off. Like that's a winter project. And it's gonna snow tomorrow. So I'm gonna take it easy. This thing is definitely beat the crap up. Like I said, I feel sorry for a rental unit. But I got most of this stuff to take grease. Pretty happy about that. I'm actually scared to look at this thing anymore. Everywhere I look, it's breaking up. So, and that's, Dagoman is built like a tank. It's really heavy stuff. So that's saying something. Man, that really surprises me, to be quite honest with you. Like Dagoman, like I said, Dagoman's built like a tank. But I guess you get people who don't care because it's just rental equipment. And man, I don't know how you make money renting. I really don't. But anyways, hopefully I'm not the one it breaks on. And hopefully this winter they can get it to a machine shop. And get it all fixed up. Because it's not that old of a machine. Like, it's got to be like a 17 or something. Anyways, we're on the highway. I will see you when we get to the field. How's that sound? P.S. I also forgot to mention how quiet this cab is. I know you guys have some questions. So one question is, Mike, how come we didn't see the 1050 on a grain cart this year? Well, the reason is because I only have 227 hours and I'm not sure if I'm gonna keep it. I might sell it. And I didn't, and since I wasn't sure about that, I didn't want to hour it up. But this kind of work is perfect for the 1050. The drill is too much for it. But the Protill and the grain cart, like you couldn't ask for a nicer tractor. 500 horsepower suits it. It's super quiet in here. It's very smooth. Yeah, it rides awesome. But the downside is it's super duper expensive if you can't pull a drill. I And Mike, well, Mike, I have questions. You say that you can pull a drill. You're just asking too much out of that tractor, Mike. You're just asking too much out. That's the problem. Get a smaller drill, problem solved. Actually, that's not true. This tractor with its 68-foot, 12-inch space with mid-roll banders pulling a 950 cart has the same horsepower per opener as our 620 quads do pulling 84-feet, 12-inch space mid-roll banders. The thing is, they're pulling a bigger cart with their same horsepower, 7.3 horsepower per opener. Make sense? Basically, what I'm telling you is, this tractor has the exact same horsepower per shank as the big tractors do, because the big tractors are pulling a bigger drill. In fact, the big tractors have it even worse, because they're pulling a 1350 cart back there, and this one's only pulling a 950 bushel cart. So this one should actually be able to walk away with its drill over the quad tracks, but that's not the case at all. We can't barely keep speed on a flat surface, where the quad tracks will easily walk away with this thing. And this thing is just as much, actually more money than a quad track. So when you figure it like that, it just, I don't know how you can make sense of that. You know what I mean? But beautiful tractor, don't get me wrong. Anyways, I hooked it up to the Protill because this is what every farmer loves. Go do some tillage. And what better than to use the 1050? So I just want to talk about the video quality here for a second. This is how I always used to record. This is about the biggest angles you can get, because I always use stability control. That basically helps take some of the jiggle out of it when I'm moving around, and I think it's just better quality when you're actually on the when you're actually watching it on TV or whatnot. But the last few videos, I've done a lot wider angle. I'll show you. There, this is the widest angles that I can go, but I lose the stability control. So, and I've done, I think, 4 or 5 videos like this, so I'm a little worried how those have turned out, and obviously they're already out, so you guys already know that, to be like, oh man, something's definitely gone wrong here, or it's reasonable. But there's some cool, I kind of like having the wide angle at sometimes, so I guess you guys tell me. Otherwise, I'm going to go back to the normal, because I don't want, if you guys are watching this on a TV, I don't want you guys to hate me. Hey, we just got to the field here. I just finished moving my hydraulics around. I love that option and I can do that. Now, I'm going to wing this thing out. Figure out, oh, no, that's the wrong one. Pick them up first. Oh, wrong way. There we go. Normally both wings go together. Surprise. Oh well. No big deal. Oh, hold on here. Okay, now I'm gonna lower it down. Yeah, picked up on the hitch. There's a lot of weight there. We're trying to lower it down. Okay, now with Dagelman Protills, it is imperative, super imperative. You see the that float icon right there? It says place in float. Yeah. That means the two hydraulics we just used to wing this thing out, which is that one right there. Let's see if I can zoom in on this a little bit better. That one right there, and then these two right here that lifted it up, they have to be in float. And then these ones, you just hit this, puts the float symbol on the monitor. If those are not in float, you will severely damage this machine. So I think that's why everyone's little hesitant about renting these things, because that cylinder over there is leaking. Could be a tell time that maybe there's some issue there. No, that's not the one you'd have to have on float. But anyway, you would do a lot of damage to this thing if you didn't have it on float, just FYI. So now that they are, let's go protilling. It's working up really good right now because we had some snow first, remember? See all this Russian thistle and the chickpeas? We had to leave it, we couldn't get through it. well, we could get through with the combine, but it was toughening up the sample too much. So we decided that that's it. We're leaving it, and now I'm just disking it under. This is some new land that we took on, and it's going to take a few years to get these weeds under control. So the reason why I'm doing this is because we're not going to get through this stuff with the drill next year, so I want to make sure we get it all worked up and make our life a lot easier next year. So I am in full auto mode here. Auto transmission. Typically I run 4% when it's on a drill to get a little more speed out of it. We're doing about 10 miles an hour. We're on TMS mode, which means it just gives the RPM as it needs it. But we are working the tractor because we're barely maintaining 10 mile an hour, and I have it on cruise at 10 mile an hour. So yeah, all this stuff I gotta work up out here. Everything we left. Mike, why don't you just come back with a combine? Because it's like 70 kilometers away and it's not worth coming back for a combine. And I gotta work up some grass out here that we sprayed out. So I'll show you that later too. Now, I'm not a big fan of the TMS, to be honest with you. I'm not worried about a little bit of fuel savings. Because what happens is, I'll show you, but when we go around a corner, when we lift the Protill out of the ground, it will actually idle the tractor down. You know, it will idle it down to almost 1,000 RPM, no big deal. And then as soon as you set the Protill back into the ground, it goes blue, it lugs it down for that split second before the transmission will catch up. And I don't like that little log down every time you gotta turn a corner, because all you're doing out here is turning corners. So typically, what I will end up doing is I'm just gonna be running it up to about probably 1500 RPM where it thinks I should be, and I'll just run it there. I'm not too worried about the fuel savings. Climbing a bit up a hill here. We're down to 8.5 mile an hour. That's all we got, 8.3. Remember, we're on cruise at 10. We're trying to do 10. So it takes a lot of power to pull these Dagelman Protills. I'll give you a different angle here. There we go. Come on, baby. Come on, baby. Come on, baby. Come on, baby. Just about need 600 horsepower on these Dagelmans. Still at cruise at 10 mile an hour here. We're cornering fast. We're gonna go get this spiffle over here that we left. Now look, it's idling my tractor down, right? Now I'm gonna set this thing in the ground right now. Look at that. See that little lug down? I don't like that at all. So we're just gonna forget that. Let's give me some juice here. Actually, we're balls out right now, to be quite honest. Come on, baby. I'll lift it out of the ground here in a second. Idle it down a little bit. Yeah, that's where I'm pretty much gonna keep it. Go find some more stuff to work under. Okay, let's get out and see what kind of job we're gonna do. I will warn you, it's like 70K winds out there, so maybe turn down your mic just a little bit. Okay. No frost in this stuff, it's working up really good, so there's notched blades on the front.
Missing a disc there. The last guy, must be. Notched on the front, smooth on the back. Ours is notched on the front and notched on the back. Then it has these rubber packers. I'm a rubber packer kind of guy. Versus the cages. So it's doing really good. Lots of moisture. I like that it packs it back down. It would pack it down probably a little bit more and do a cleaner job if you weren't doing 10 mile an hour, but that's pretty much what you gotta do with these things, is about 10 mile an hour. I won't go over 10, between 8 and 10. Depend if you're trying to bury trash. Ah, I love the smell of dirt. I love the smell of dirt, guys. Oh, it's windy. Okay, we're gonna get going here. There's some big kochia weed that we're going through. It's all alkali in here. This thing does a really nice job of it. Oh, these things are like 4 or 5 feet tall in here. Finally find my Protill. Deer. It's a hard pull. We're wide open. We can't maintain 10. Here's the grass that I sprayed out. You can see the line. There. So this used to be grass and alfalfa. We're just gonna work this too. It's working up really nice. The difference between the Dagelman and the Lemkin is the Lemkin is in two pieces. The Dagelman is actually in three. So you have way better molding capabilities with the Dagelman. Like it will actually mold over the hills, where the Lemkin's only two, right? So Dagelman's 3-plex. that gets duplex.
Also, when you pick it up, sorry about that, when you pick up, you're lifting on four wheels, four big wheels on the front, and the roller packers on the back. Where the Lemkin, you lift it up, you gotta lift up the packers and everything only on two wheels. So I don't really like how much weight it puts on those wheels. On the Lemkin, I'm talking. I prefer when you lift out of the ground on the Degelman, because it picks up four wheels, picks up, puts the weight on four wheels, and the rubber packers on the back. So here's a slew. It's quite a big one. Goes all the way around that extra, all that brown out there. It's a really big slew. So we're working up this slew. So that's one of the things we're doing out here. We're working up chickpeas, as you know, that were too weedy to combine. Why were they too weedy to combine? Great question. It's because the Russian thistle was quite green and it was actually causing the chickpeas to get too tough. So we actually had to leave them, or we were gonna ruin the good chickpeas that we had. And it wasn't a lot of acres, but we're too far away to come back with a combine for a little bit like that. And then we're working sloughs, and we're working up ruts, like what we were doing up north. Tractor's so quiet, isn't it? It's a really big slough. Holy cow. I'm gonna be out here for a while. Here's some more of the chickpeas and Russian thistle that we're working up. That's the slough. Don't worry, I don't have that slough done yet. Pick up on this thing. Do a corner. Job. Really good job. Missing a little bit there. It's kind of hard to do this with only two hands. I need another hand. One last swipe here. And we'll go back to that slough. Alright. Grab this little miss just to make it look good. Okay. I guess before I do that, look at all these little chunks I gotta do out here. One here, there, there, over on the other side, here. So yeah. See if I can do this with my... There we go. Okay, now once we get up over here, I'm going to show you how this Degelman molds to the ground and why it's so important to have your some of your hydro transport cylinders in float. So this is kind of a road allowance right here. That's actually still shaped like a bit of a road. but we're gonna go right up and over it. I'm gonna show you what this thing's gonna do.
Sorry. See, look at how it's molding. I really like how that molds.
That way you can go up over hills and it just molds up over hills. Got good flex. Flex. Flex and flex. Flex, flex.
Okay.
So that's it, guys. I will see you tomorrow. This video's too long as it is. And we'll do a part two. Adios, amigos.